This is Chicago. At the dawn of the 21st century, Chicago's media was dominated by a handful of major corporations. But a resistance movement arose to free Chicago's media from their clutches. One player in this movement is the Chicago Independent Media Center and its TV show, Chicago Independent Television. The Independent Media Center is a worldwide network of grassroots correspondents committed to using the tools of the media for promoting social and economic justice. You are watching this month's dispatch from the Chicago Independent Media Center.
Welcome to Chicago Independent Television, a collection of progressive video reports by grassroots media workers produced free from corporate or commercial support or influence. I'm your host, Gwendolyn Chubb. In this episode, we'll go to the streets to join the global march against Monsanto and also join a vigil held in Chicago in memory of the victims of the Charleston massacre. We will also hear about the folks at Civiclab. All that and more coming up. Stay with us.
In 1914, Woodrow Wilson signed the bill that created the Fed. He thought it was one of the worst days of his life, and he had destroyed the country. He hadn't destroyed the country. He destroyed the world. Put an end to this now!
Welcome back to Chicago Independent Television. The Organic Consumers Association, along with many other groups, rallied in support for labeling genetically modified organisms, or GMOs, and voicing their concerns around GMO crops, cattle, and their consumption, which we'll see in this segment.
Behind intellectual property law to keep scientists from doing rigorous testing that could produce results contrary to their scientific, their commercial interests. Isn't this anti-science? Yes. These companies intentionally mislead the public, trumpeting only the findings of the scientific organizations that support their views, while ignoring the ones that express doubts about their safety. Isn't this anti-science? Yes. These companies orchestrate smear campaigns against scientists who do produce experimental results showing the dangers of these products. I'd say this too was anti-science, right? Yeah, isn't this anti-science? Yes. So don't let anyone call you anti-science because you insist on scientific testing for every genetically engineered food on the market. And this means independent testing with the necessary safeguards to assure adequacy and impartiality. We are the ones who are for science. We are the ones who are for honest science. And Monsanto and its allies, they're the ones who are anti-science. Their day is almost over.
And I met the CEO of Monsanto, and I said to him, "You know, Mr. Grant, it takes a big man to make a big and powerful company, but it takes an even bigger man to acknowledge when something's not working and to go into a new direction." And he said, and I said, "So I look forward to the day when Monsanto goes in the direction which does not harm our children." And he said, "Well, we have all kinds of science and we're going in new directions all the time." And I said, "We have science that your products harm our children. And just consider, if you're wrong, the repercussions to your company are enormous and the repercussions to the world are huge." And he said, "Well, if you're wrong, you're scaring an awful lot of people." And I said, "If I were wrong, wrong and I'm not, then all the only repercussion to the people is that they're eating organic. And there is nothing wrong with organic food. It is perfect the way it is.
We need to remind Jan Schakowsky politely. She's our friend. She's the one who first got labels, in fact, food ingredients labeled on all our, you know, mandatory ingredients on our labels in the first place, on our food packaging. It was her. And she deserves a lot of credit for that. But, you know, politicians need a good nudge in the side. Sometimes they need a push. That's what we're going to do.
Monsanto and many of the biotech industries that are trying to sell us their seeds have corporatized and in many cases privatized ownership of what is biological, something that belongs to nature, something that no man can possess. And we're here to take back our food system, to say we will not stand for the commodification of the things that are the most important to us. The food that we eat and the water that we drink, water that we do not want to drink polluted with pesticides and agrochemicals. So we've worked hard to promote SB 734, the genetically engineered food labeling act here in our Senate. We have gotten many, many letters written by people that are here right now that we will deliver to the Senate President, John Cullerton, next Friday. Let's hear it for John Cullerton, the man who is preventing us from seeing food labels. We give him a boo!
We don't really know what's happening with our food, and that's why it's really important to garden if we can, because then we know where the food is coming from. Another issue related to food security is we probably all here buy organic when we can, and we know that organic is not cheap, right? It's usually way more expensive than conventionally grown produce. So if we start gardening and we have gardens, then our neighbors see it, and then we can talk to them about these kinds of topics. You go to the grocery store and you have to buy these pears, and the pears are $1.99 a pound, but you could have a pear tree and have pears for 20 years plus, or your tomatoes, and we can save these heirloom varieties that are quickly disappearing because we are a monocrop culture.
Bad news is that last night the U.S. Senate passed Fast Track, Trade Promotion Authority. If you didn't know it happened close to midnight. Actually, got about 10 p.m. But in any case, it's now going to the House, and it's in the House where we have a better chance of stopping it. We knew that early on. And what Fast Track does is the House will have to cede its authority over trade, international trade, something that they would have to do. They would have to vote to cut their own responsibility. That means they can cut and run. They don't have to take responsibility.
The objective of companies like Monsanto is not quality of food, but about greed, control, and monopoly. It's not to protect life and environment, but to protect their money.
Thank you, everybody, so much for coming out. We have a really good turnout today. I'm so excited to see all of you. I am going to back up what that doctor just said, because I know from personal experience that everything that she just said is true, and I don't need anyone to approve it or put a stamp on it and tell me that it's true, because I lived through it with my little girl. She was the one with the bullhorn yelling at the GMO people, if any of you guys saw her. She, on her sign, she wanted to draw a picture of herself in the hospital, hooked up to all of those IVs and PICC lines and the oxygen. For the last 3 years, in about 2 weeks, it'll be 3 years that she has been completely healthy. And it's because I cut all of that garbage out of her diet. It was killing her. I almost lost her. I spent 7 days in the PICU, no sleep. I was losing her. She pulled through, and I decided that we really needed to make some life changes. And she has been perfectly healthy since. Monsanto is the largest multinational GMO bioengineering company And it's just nobody that creates pesticides and manufactures all of this stuff should have anything to do with our food. That right there is a red flag. So I don't know how anyone could think that any of that is okay. Poison, food, they don't go together. It's common sense, it's not science. I just hope that being here and seeing my healthy, beautiful little girl here, maybe, you know, one of us could make a difference in someone's life that maybe has going through something with their child, you know, what the way I was going through with her. And I was fortunate enough to stumble upon this information, and I ran with it. So I just hope that anybody, if you know anybody that's going through this, please let them know. This is not like some hippie mumbo jumbo. It's true. It is bad for you. It will cause digestive issues, skin problems. I can't even go into all the stuff that was wrong with her. She was on antibiotics at least 2 or 3 times a month. It was just horrific. She has not taken medicine in 3 years. She is fine. But please just spread the word. I am here today to let you guys know about my personal experience because I do take this Monsanto thing personally because it affected my family. And I almost lost a family member because of it. And I don't care who thinks I'm crazy, you know what, I'm still gonna keep talking. And I'm gonna keep spreading my truth and hopefully make a difference in another mother's life or another child's life. Because these kids are the ones that are gonna have to deal with it later on, and their children. Okay, so we need to keep them healthy and keep their minds right and teach them the truth so they can keep it going. She and I are marching here today. I'm marching for her. I'm marching for every single child here, all of the children across the world, anybody that has been affected by this horrific company that has no business even existing. And that's why we're here. And I hope that's why you guys are here too. From Chicago Anonymous, Monsanto, you should have expected us.
Tron T. Juan was born in 1986 with one hand and no legs. Like 3 million other Vietnamese people, she is a victim of dioxin poisoning from Agent Orange. Her birth defects were a direct result of her parents' exposure to this terrible poison. American scientists in Monsanto and Dow Chemical knew about the extreme dangers of dioxin while the United States was dumping 20 million gallons of Agent Orange on South Vietnam from 1961 to 1971.
As you may know, GMOs and the companies that promote them are extremely powerful forces in all levels of government. It's taken us the years since then to promote, education, understanding, and a counter-argument to the things that our legislators are hearing from the biotech industry. But it's not enough to get people educated. Our legislators are not voting against us because they don't understand. They're voting against us because they are heavily influenced by corporate dollars and because they do not hear enough from their constituents. I want to repeat that. They do not hear enough from their constituents. They think that they can vote against us and our rights and our interests, and no one will notice.
Monsanto! We know you know we're here! We're saving our seeds! Monsanto is the devil!
Store in Logan Square with a focus on local sourcing, on organic sourcing. And we're here to march today to spread the message that I think is at the heart of this struggle, and that's ownership. Who owns the land? Who owns the seeds? Who are the middlemen in all the transactions? And with a community-owned grocery store, the profits go back into the community that it serves.
I have a book here that I've been reading, Poison Spring. And in Poison Spring, it states that the U.S. EPA is the most corrupt agency in the United States. And the reason why, because the decisions that they make among all the other agencies is the most important decision that they make, because it determines the health and welfare of the public here in the USA. And they haven't even banned Roundup, where the World Health Organization says it's a probable cause of cancer.
Concerned about what's happening to our food because of GMOs and Roundup. I want to share for a moment my family story. My husband and my son both have celiac disease, and I have gluten sensitivity. And my husband was so sick he could have died. He didn't know he had celiac disease. And none of us can eat gluten or we get very sick. And we also feel sick when we eat GMOs. So we do everything that we can to avoid eating GMOs.
GMOs!
People have the right to know!
In their offices.
Cook organic, not the planet. Cook organic, not the planet. Cook organic. Oh, salute everybody, thank you!
I've got an idea. I just so happen to have a toll-free phone number that can connect us to the Senate President's office, John Cullerton. If he's going to stand between us and our right to know, I think it's time we give him a call and let him know how that makes us feel. So, I need you to take out your phones. I'm not even kidding. Get your phone out right now. I saw you take a picture. I know you've got it with you. So you're gonna call this number. You'll hear a recording of my beautiful voice, and you'll be connected to his office. And you just need to let the Senate President know that it is our right to know what we are eating, what we are feeding our children, and we will not tolerate his delays and the blockage of our right to know in Illinois. So the phone number is 888-498-2945. Again, 888-498-2945. I see many of you are still leaving voicemails. This is good.
Welcome back to Chicago Independent Television. In this segment, we'll join a vigil held in Chicago in memory of the victims of the Charleston massacre and to raise awareness of the prevalence of white supremacy groups.
The guy went in saying that the issue was black men raping white women, and then he proceeded to kill six black women.
It is our duty to not allow this to be swept into some corner as some aberration of history. This is just another example of the history we're all living.
So I'm reading I Believe in Living by Asada Shakur. I believe in living. I believe in the spectrum of beta days and gamma people. I believe in sunshine and windmills and waterfalls, tricycles and rocking chairs, and I believe that seeds grow into sprouts, and sprouts grow into trees. I believe in the magic of the hands and the wisdom of the eyes. I believe in rain and tears and in the blood of infinity. I believe in life, and I've seen the death parade, march through the torso of the earth, sculpting mud bodies in its path. I've seen the destruction of the daylight and seen bloodthirsty maggots prayed to and saluted. I've seen the kind become the blind and the blind become the bind in one easy lesson. I've walked on cut grass. I've eaten crow and blundered bread and breathed the stench of indifference. I've been locked by the lawless, handcuffed by the haters, gagged by the greedy, and if I know anything at all, it's that a wall is just a wall and nothing more at all. It can be broken down. I believe in living. I believe in birth. I believe in the sweat of love and in the fire of truth. And I believe that a lost ship steered by tired, seasick sailors can still be guided home to port.
this segment, we'll hear the progress that Civiclab has made in Chicago.
The Civiclab opened on July 1st, 2013, and now, after 2 years, we're closing our doors on June 30th, 2015. We've hosted amazing groups here who've worked and prospered, including Chicago Votes, the Roosevelt Institute, Moms United Against Violence and Incarceration, the People's Institute for Housing Justice, and we've housed the TIFF Illumination Project at the Civic Lab. Mike Donnelly and Carmilla Manzanet are two activists who have experienced homelessness through the machinations of a hedge fund.
Cold-hearted.
Manipulators.
Shallow.
Carpetbaggers.
Uncaring.
People who come in and are taking advantage of a situation for their own gain.
They just want your money.
While claiming that they're doing good for everyone.
Came homeless in 2013 due to an issue I was having with CHA.
Yeah, we occupied a bank-owned home and the police came and evicted us. Shortly thereafter, you know, in the course of being illegally locked out, that the company that purchased the home was Invitation Homes. And Invitation Homes is a subsidiary of a Wall Street giant by the name of the Blackstone Group. They're a worldwide vulture private equity hedge fund. We were treated so harshly by the subsidiary of Blackstone that it drove us to want to know more about what they were doing, and if they could do this to people who were squatting or occupying a home, what would they do to people who would actually become renters? We know that they're crooks because they participated in subprime loans and have gotten all of GE's real estate for $23.5 billion.
So Brandon Smith and a group of working journalists have been coding and working on a project that will make it easy for whistleblowers to connect with journalists in a secure way.
It's building an instance of SecureDrop. It's kind of a fancy software package that allows sources to get in contact with journalists in a secure manner. It's taken so long because of all kinds of security considerations. We've been working on it for a year or so. We're sort of in the last little parts of making it a reality.
All this is without spending a dime. We have no money here at the Civic Lab. Everything's a volunteer basis. It's one of the reasons why we have to close. We just couldn't figure out quite how to pull it together to get enough people to work here to pay our bills.
This is Jill Stein. You're watching Chicago Independent Television.